Hello, hello, you guys. Carmen here. I'm going to give us just a few seconds here because it looks like we're live. There's always a little bit of a delay, so I like to watch to make sure that there are people that join. Hopefully, wouldn't that be terrible if nobody was here? Let me take a look. If somebody can give me a thumbs up, let me know that you hear me and see me. Let me take a look. Okay, I'll wait. I'm gonna get started. So I see some peeps here. Great. So a couple things. I, again, am trying to mess with this image. Thank you, Jamie. I appreciate that. Lots of feedback. Everybody still keeps saying, you know, we have the slides, they're great, but can we see more of you? So I have changed it up a little bit more again, so it's weird. I also do have a second screen here. I hope you guys realize that. So if I'm looking over here, hi, Leslie. If I'm looking over here to the right, I'm not looking out the window. I've got a screen there. Now that you guys are giving me some feedback, I'm gonna just flip my phone over here so that that is not distracting. And let's get ready to dive in. So we're here. Hi, Martha. We're here in lesson three. I did also forget to tell you guys, I just tried to choke on my drink. So we'll probably have to deal with that for a minute. We're in lesson three. So remember at the beginning where I told you I teach, everything I teach really is a framework or a roadmap, because I feel like we all like to know where we're at and where we're headed. So this is a three-step process. First, we work on clarity, then commit, and then complete. So that's what we're going to be doing tonight in lesson three, is moving on to the commit part. So we're gonna talk about your goals. We're gonna revisit the functional assessment and look at, you know, just try and refresh your memory if you have questions on, is this impairment or is it a physical barrier? Meaning, do I have just myofunctional impairment? Do I have a tongue tie? So we'll look at that again. We'll talk about options. We'll look at frequent questions that I have been compiling from you guys all week. So first, let's talk about clarity. This is something that I have most of my one-on-one clients do. And really that's because A, I work in wellness, and I really feel like it helps you understand it helps you point your ship if you know why you want to make these changes, why you want to not only just release your tongue tie, but why you want to fix these other things. Because at risk of, again, sounding like a snake oil salesman, these are life-changing outcomes for people. Everybody is a little bit different. If you've been through this process, I just lived through it because I obviously haven't done it. So I live vicariously through everybody else. The clarity exercise is in your workbook. Take the time to do it. Think about what matters to you, what you want to accomplish. What I do want you to think about is this. Are you looking for a Band-Aid or are you looking for root cause resolution? Because in this group, in this mini course, I'm talking to adults, so we're not in a hurry here. Yes, I want you to do something about your tongue tie yesterday, but I don't want you to jump out of the frying pan into the flame. So we got to make the right decisions, but some people don't necessarily want to do it the right way. They're looking for a Band-Aid, and unfortunately in medicine and dentistry these days, you're gonna find a lot of Band-Aids. If that's what you're looking for, something short-term, I think, or not necessarily just short-term, but like you only want to focus on one thing right now, which could be the tie, and then worry about everything else later, those are things that are important, because those are gonna be things that you're gonna wanna convey to me, somebody else, yourself. Root cause resolution takes a little bit more elbow grease. Going back to those Band-Aids, you could go to any dentist in the country and somebody's going to give you an appliance for snoring. Somebody's going to give you an appliance for grinding your teeth. It's a Band-Aid on a bullet wound. I know that there's a time and a place for those appliances and I don't have a problem with them. But what I do have a problem with is the fact that they do it without properly screening you for tongue ties and sleep apnea. Okay, so think about that. So then the second step, so the first step is clarity, the second step is commit, and that's just figuring out like, okay, can I do this? Do I want to do it? Am I ready? So we're going to be focusing on that tonight. I'm going to help you understand your outcomes. make you think about whether you're ready or not and then what your options are. So first, let's jump into understanding the outcome, what you learned in lesson one and two. So what I first want you to think about is, what does your discovery checklist look like? If it looks like a kindergartner got a hold of it with a crayon, then you know you've got a concern. If it's blank, two things happen. You wasted your time and you didn't do it completely, or you didn't think it through, or you don't have concerns. I feel like if you're here, it's probably not blank. So let's continue on with that. Remember, when I do an exam with somebody, I'm looking for three things. I'm looking first and foremost to identify airway crisis, which often catches people off guard when they come to me and they're worried about or curious about a tongue tie. And I tell them, sister, you got a sleep problem. You have an airway problem. We need to deal with that first. So that's the first and foremost thing. Then I look at a tie. Do you have a tie? Do you just have impairment? The outcome is the same. We just have an extra step or two, really, of if somebody has a tongue tie. And then last, I'm looking to identify orofacial myofunctional disorders. So when I say, what does your discovery checklist look like? I want to tell you how it works in my world. Every single time I meet somebody, every single time somebody provides a checklist to me, I'm always looking to justify why I recommend a release. I always think that, okay, so if Dr. Zoggy called me up tomorrow and said, hey, Carmen, why did you tell Betty Sue that she should have a release? I want to be able to look at this sheet and say, well, she couldn't breastfeed and she had chronic ear infections and she was colicky and spit up and, you know, all these things as a child. I want to be able to look and say, she's got digestive issues this long. She's not sleeping. She's got relapsed ortho, speech impediments, you know, all of those things. Every single time I'm working with somebody, I'm looking to justify that. I know that there's a lot of people who are taking in this group, watching these videos, and or who are here right now who are either providers, you know, maybe a speech therapist, maybe a dental hygienist, and they're here to learn and they're practicing and they're not confident in how to identify it. And for me, thankfully, this has always been so easy for me because I feel like I'm just picking up clues. I'm digging. I'm just supporting. Yes, this is what I see. This is what I don't see. And I mentioned this last night. Remember, this isn't a huge, huge decision. I know it feels like it for you, but if you can't go wrong. You really can't go wrong. So I want you to feel like you're confident in being able to identify. And for those of you who are practicing and do what I do, to be able to justify why you would send somebody for a release. It's, I think, easier than you make it out to be. First, let's talk about airway crisis. So if this is you, think about if you have craniofacial anomalies. Remember, the first priority is airway. So do you have a super narrow arch? Because we know if you're narrow, if your arch is high and narrow, that the face did not develop correctly. The maxilla needs to be strong and forward, and then the mandible will follow. When the mandible grows properly and it follows the maxilla, it's like a lid on the box. So when the mandible grows forward, we don't end up with a receded chin. It takes the airway with it. It takes the soft tissues. It takes the tongue with it. So we don't have that obstruction. If you're somebody with a very narrow arch, you got to think about, okay, do I have an airway concern? If you're somebody with a receded chin, look in the mirror, look at your nose, upper lip, lower lip, chin. If it's going backwards, you have insufficient craniofacial growth, a receded chin. It's called a lot of different things, but that just tells you that, okay, maybe my airway volume isn't as big as it should be. Okay. Next, grinding. You guys probably have heard this from me time and time again. Your body grind, when you grind, that's your body's 911 call. Grinding appliances, while they are there to do the job of protecting the teeth, they don't stop the grinding. Any of you who wear a grinding appliance know that you buy more than one in a lifetime. It records the crime, okay? And again, I am just gonna give you my experience about grinding appliances. I don't want you to blow up my email if your office or your dentist or your situation is a little bit different. But after 16 years in hygiene, I have seen and I'm so frustrated with the grinding appliance market, because I have had and worked for dentists where they walk in and they talk about production numbers. And so they will say, we're going to really focus this week on wear facets, on people grinding. And I'm fine with that if it's legit. But what I don't like to see is when we give somebody a Band-Aid and we don't dig deeper. We're not looking for why. I have a clients who will come to me, will be doing an exam, and they'll say, okay, so I'm supposed to pick up my grinding, you know, my night guard this week, or the doctor wanted me to come back and do it. And all I say is, wait. There's no harm in waiting, because very often when my clients get their release done, most of them stop grinding right away. And it's always their decision. I never tell somebody to stop wearing it, but I don't want you to spend $400 to $800 on an appliance that's not answering the problem, okay? So grinding is a big concern. And then last, are you somebody with sleep disordered breathing? I always say that this is like the rungs on a ladder. Are you mouth breathing? Are you snoring? Do you have upper airway resistance syndrome? Do you have sleep apnea? These are things that you don't want to overlook. Obviously, mouth breathing is very unhealthy for you. It's not as bad as sleep apnea, just because I know how bad sleep apnea is and how degenerative it is. But you don't want to progress along that continuum. So I want you to take that real serious. I touched on this last night. I wanted to make sure that these slides are in here about sleep apnea, because a lot of these things are on the discovery checklist. I feel like sometimes it takes, well, I think the statistics say you've got to see something 6 or 7 times before you start to own it. So I put this here so that if it's you, if it's your spouse, if it's your mom, dad, uncle, brother, sister, anybody, these are pages out of my sleep apnea guide that help answer more questions. So if you experience any of the following problems, if you have any of these symptoms, if you have any of these physical features or these medical problems, you guys, sleep apnea does not discriminate, okay? We used to think that it was always a middle-aged fat man with a big neck. Not the case. It hits everybody. It hits all ages, genders. I'm seeing it so much in children. And also the medical problem. So just a couple fun facts. People who have obstructive sleep apnea, 50% of them have high blood pressure. So if you're somebody who has sleep concerns, and maybe you're suspecting it, but you're taking a high blood pressure medicine, maybe it's worth thinking about. Also diabetes. 40% of people who have sleep apnea have diabetes. So doesn't it make sense if we cross-reference, if we cross, not necessarily reference, but if somebody has one, that we're thinking about the other? So think about these things, because I have had both physicians, I have had physicians' wives, you know, two separate people, that say, I had no idea what sleep apnea was. So the doctor said, I didn't know what a good night's sleep was. I had no idea I had sleep apnea symptoms until I saw something like this. I answered the questions and went through and found, like, he had severe apnea. He had to have a CPAP. Another lady is a physician's wife. She didn't think she had sleep apnea. I did an exam with her. She said, no, I know what this looks like because I'm married to a doctor. He has sleep apnea. I know what it looks like. I know what all the signs are. I know everything. And guess what? She was diagnosed with moderate sleep apnea. So not just mild. So it doesn't just happen to other people. It happens to everybody. And sometimes you don't think it can happen to you. So take these serious. And then last is the Epworth sleepiness scale. Again, if you do it and you scale, or if you score 11 or above, talk to your doctor. If your doctor does not seem to be a forward-thinking person, then perhaps it's time to have a new doctor. Because some doctors will say, oh no, they'll take a look at you and say, oh no, you're fine. But that's not, we don't decide that by how somebody looks. And like I said, they used to think that it was just that, you know, the heavyweight or overweight middle-aged man with a big neck who snores or whatever, and that's not the case. Okay, so next. So I look for airway concern, then I'm looking, is there a tongue tie or is there just impairment? Again, we're not betting the farm here, you guys. One thing I want to ask you is, do your symptoms seem to connect with what I have taught you? That's what I tell every single person that I do an exam on. I feel like my job at the end is for you to have no questions and to understand how everything is connected. People come into my exams thinking that there's no way that this is connected to this, or why am I asking about ear infections as an infant? So think about that for yourself. As you're trying to, maybe you already know you have a tongue tie, or maybe you're still trying to confidently make that decision, I want you to think about your symptoms. Let's go over the functional assessment again quickly. So remember, there's general tests and then there's functional tests. The general tests are the range of motion. Then we look at how the tongue changes shape when it's elevated. And then we look at where the frenum fixates or inserts on the tongue. So in this picture, you don't have to have these range of motion scales. Sometimes you might have the opportunity to have a measurement. Most people, my clients around the world, obviously don't. But you don't need this. Remember, the photo on the left is max opening, and then the photo on the right is the max opening with the tongue tipped to the incisive papilla. The incisive papilla is that speed bump behind your top front teeth. It also houses the vagus nerve ending. So the vagus nerve is the largest cranial nerve responsible for regulation of breathing, regulation of digestion, anxiety, those things. So having tongue on the spot is not just merely a spot that we say, hey, this looks like a good spot. There's a reason. So when you're taking this measurement, we're just looking at the percentage of change. If you're trying to figure out, hey, do I have a concern in this area? Open wide. And then raise the tongue up to the spot. I have 100% range of motion because I don't have to close down at all. If you have to close down significantly or a little bit, you're just judging it. This isn't rocket science right now. Yes, it's a piece of information that goes into my client files when they start therapy with me, when they get their kit, when we do these final pictures. But to start with, it certainly is the least useful piece of information for me in identifying a tie. Okay, so now I'm going to move this picture of me over here just a little bit for a few slides. So next is looking at the shape of the tongue. So we went over this last night. If you raise the tongue, first of all, you're going to open your mouth wide. You're not trying to reach the palate. You're trying to just see what the tongue looks like. In this slide, clearly this is a heart-shaped tongue. Okay, so that's a classic, obvious tie. But look at what yours looks like. So we're looking to see, as you lift it, what does it look like? Does it have heart shape? Everybody always thinks that it can only be a heart shape or there's no tongue tie, which is not the case. There we go. So frenum fixation. Remember, there's two spots. So we look at it where it attaches on the tongue. We look at it where it attaches down here, either the floor of the mouth or the alveolar ridge here. So this picture from last night is an Eiffel Tower tie, and that's worse. But if you have a tongue tie that, if that frenum attaches to the floor of the mouth and you lift the tongue and it looks like somebody has a suction and it's taking the floor of the mouth with, that doesn't make it normal, okay? Just because it doesn't attach at the alveolar ridge, that doesn't make it normal. So we're looking at that. Remember the other thing, you guys, I said last night, we talked about the five different frenums. But you gotta use common sense here. I know it's not about appearance, but when I look at this picture of my sweet granddaughter, it just looks obvious to me that not only is her frenum short, but it's way back. And so, yeah, She could do a lot. She could probably lick an ice cream cone like nobody's business. But the fact that she choked on everything she ate and vomited is explained by this. And I always tell people, yes, I worry about this part. Yes, I worry about the traditional tongue tie. But because I see so many people that are older and that my practice has really evolved into specializing working with these group of people, it's so hard. It's so hard to teach somebody who's older how to get the back of the tongue to function and how to swallow properly. Okay, I kind of got off on a tangent there, which won't be the first time. Okay, so functional tests. Let's look at those, if I can get it to go. Let me get out of the way again. Okay, so can you elevate the tongue as a whole? Remember the board, remember the lever, not just the tip. I want you to be evaluating yourself whether you can elevate the whole thing. This is going to be finicky now. Protrude and retract. So Lindsay here in this picture, she's flopping out a pancake. She has no control. Versus when I showed it to you guys last night, I was saying, ideally, you can lift the tongue up. You can have it like levitate right in the middle of your mouth and you are controlling it. She has no control there. The other thing is notice that her tongue falls down. She simply can't hold it up. And that is weakness, or is that a tongue tie that's pulling it down? So you just have to kind of look at how big of a struggle that is. Lateralization was the next functional assessment. So back and forth, side to side. Can you get the tongue off the teeth? Does it drop in the corners? Does it have one side that's worse than the other? And pay attention, what's your gut instinct? I've had clients that say, oh, it's worse on the left. It's worse over here, I can feel it. They have a release done. They tell the doctor, I feel the more of the struggle on the left. And I have had a client who went back for a second release because she could still feel like something was just pulling. They went on the left and they found more fiber. So trust your gut on what you feel. Can you reach the last molar? So, and if you can, how far can you stay open? Are you closing? Is your chin following? Does it make sense that there's a struggle? The most important, click, suction, and suction and hold. When a client is ready to have a frenectomy, they need to be able to suction like this. There are some cases that can't, but for the most part, clients need to be able to do that. And then the last functional assessment is, can they touch the upper lip without compensation? Compensation being the lips, the upper lip curling under to try and meet. Okay, and then last, once I do all of that stuff, you guys, how does it feel? Was it impossible and painful? Pretty guaranteed that that's a tie. Was it tiring or difficult? Do you feel like you just had a big old workout? That doesn't necessarily mean that there's a tie. It could just mean that you're super duper weak. So then what does your discovery checklist say? What other things, what other symptoms or concerns are you having that support that you have a tie? And I've taught you all of those things. And then what about compensation? Remember last night we talked about a grade 3 tie compensating to a 2. That's just you struggling. If it is so hard for you to do something and you're tense here and you're lifting from your clavicle, then that's compensation. So what happens when you try not to do that? That's what I would be looking at. Okay, and then the last thing when I do an exam is that I'm identifying orofacial myofunctional disorders, so OMDs. So these are disorders of the muscles and the functions of the face and mouth. If it's not operating on all 8 cylinders, then it's an OMD. That is really the simplest way to look at it. If you're doing something wrong that you're not supposed to, then that is altered function. So how I look at it is, can you successfully do the 4 goals? In myofunctional therapy, the 4 goals that we work towards when I work with somebody is correct tongue posture, which we know is tip to tail in the roof of the mouth, correct mouth posture, which is mouth closed, lips sealed, and teeth gently apart. Nasal breathing is the predominant way of breathing, and then the swallow is correct and normalized. anytime you have something that's not, you know, something that you're doing wrong, that you can't meet one of those goals, then you have an OMD. So that's how I look at it when I'm working with somebody, is do they have a problem meeting the four goals of therapy? And then I also use that to help explain to them if they can benefit from OMT. So, and every single person, if you're not doing some part of that, you don't have to be, you don't have to have trouble with all four areas. For somebody with a tongue tie, I very often have them incorrect tongue posture and their swallow is a problem. The rest of the time, they might already have closed mouth posture and be nasal breathing. So you don't have to have all four. Okay, so now let's talk about complete. So that's the final stage. So clarity, commit, complete. So first, considering a time frame. And then when you're thinking about that, you have to think about if you need other team members. So I call this the comprehensive healthcare team. And because I'm not the only part of the team, sometimes I am. Well, not necessarily, because if somebody has a tongue tie, obviously we need somebody else. But as you're doing this, and as we talk about it here in a minute, I want you to think about building your dream team. And what I mean by building your dream team is finding the right people who know about this stuff, who are very well versed. They're not just, you're probably not your family dentist. They might not be somebody that your insurance covers. And that's really hard, especially for families who are really insurance driven or really financially sensitive. They really struggle with just going with, well, I'm going to just go with my family dentist because, and we'll talk more about that here. So when we start considering if you need other team members on your team, I want to talk about first the priority, then finding your quarterback, and then that I don't want you to half-ass it. So first is priority. When you're trying to make a plan together on how to do this and what your time frame is going to be, first priority is, you probably guessed it, airway crisis or nasal breathing problem that needs to be dealt with. Remember, the four goals of therapy: tongue posture, mouth posture, swallow correct and normalized, and nasal breathing. If you can't nasal breathe, you have to get that figured out, because you can't start therapy, and I certainly don't want you to attempt to have a release when you can't do that. If there's an airway crisis, if I have somebody come to me, we do an exam, and I see that they've got big sleep concerns, I want them to have a sleep study so that we know what our plan of attack is. Nasal breathing, if somebody's got a deviated septum that needs to be fixed because they can't breathe through both nostrils, that's a concern. If you've got these nasty ginormous tonsils, they need to come out of there, or, I mean, very likely they need to come out of there. Or else they're going to continue to just make you spin your wheel. So first you got to think about priority. So think about those things. Next, number two, finding your quarterback. So who's going to do your release? You guys, I can't stress, you can't expect to find the right person in your town, county, or state. If you do, that's awesome. And as I am in practice longer, I'm getting more and more providers in different areas that I have personally interviewed and worked with, and I'm happy with their work. I have several that I have worked with and I'm not happy with their work, so I obviously don't continue referring to them. But like, for example, I'm here in Colorado. People come from five states away to see my provider here. My provider in Montana, everybody from surrounding states goes to see him. My Montana ortho clients, those people, they're traveling to Wyoming. So I want you to be open-minded enough to know you want the right person and that this person may require a little bit of travel, which requires some planning. And again, as an adult, we don't need to jump out of the frying pan into the flame. When we're talking about time frame, time is less important. I mean, I want you to take care of it immediately, of course, but kiddos definitely have more of a time-sensitive window when it comes to craniofacial growth. Adults, we're already developed. And then last, you guys, don't half-ass it. So if you prepare adequately versus just winging it, that really is the difference between success and failure. You will go into any of the Facebook groups, you can ask people, there's always going to be that person that says, well, I did it and I didn't have any therapy, and I just went to Joe Blow, my local dentist, and I was fine. They might be fine because they might have had a severe, terrible tie, and maybe they went from 10% range of motion and now they're at 40. But I don't consider that okay for my clients. So I just want you to know that yes, there's people out there. Everybody has a different kind of a story. And if you know and understand why it's important to do it the right way, that helps you make those decisions. Now, one of the questions that I get asked a lot is, can I do these appointments simultaneously? When I'm having to get somebody else on my team, do I have to do those at different times? Because you might need to see an allergist. If you can't get congestion under control, perhaps you're allergic to something. Medicine to start with is always great. It helps us break that congestion cycle and get, the goal is to eventually get you off the meds. But yes, you don't necessarily have to wait. If I send somebody for a sleep study, they don't necessarily have to wait. If somebody can't nasal breathe, they have to wait because I don't want to start the clock ticking on their therapy when they're going to really struggle. So under most circumstances, you can do the appointment simultaneously. Okay, so what if you do nothing? Well, I hope that because you're here and perhaps you've spent the last 3 nights here learning, hopefully you're not interested in just doing nothing. Doing nothing has long-term repercussions. It's harder to correct the impairment. There's long-term consequences over time. Your body is going to help you compensate for a long time. When it gets to a point and the symptoms start to be on the rise, that's when people are really perplexed because they say, I didn't do anything different, or my headaches have really picked up in the last few years. And I hear it a lot. And I think I've shared this with you that I have a large patient population that's 50 to 80 and they're 100% mad. Okay. Half of them are mad because somebody didn't educate them and identify these concerns for them. And the other half are mad, but they're mad at themselves because they knew they had a concern and they didn't do anything about it. And so over time, this is how I meet people, is because they end up Googling or they read my blogs or something and they just get really frustrated. And it's just not magically going to improve. So no matter what you read, you aren't going to magically make that frenum different. You're not going to stretch it. You're not going to do anything that's going to change that collagen fiber. So hopefully you don't want to do nothing. Okay, so what does it take to be successful with myofunctional therapy? So I always tell my clients we work on retraining, we have to have awareness, you have exercises, you have to have consistent practice, and you have to have follow-up. So often that leads to what is the time commitment. So here I'm talking with you about, okay, think about your time frame. So what's the time commitment when you're thinking about, okay, so Carmen's saying, I got to do proper pre-procedure therapy. I have to heal properly. I have to do post-procedure therapy so that we can rehabilitate and learn the proper oral function. How long am I going to have to do this every day? So, excellent question. I teach two different types of exercises. I teach a passive exercise and I teach an active exercise. If I have you doing active exercises, that might be two or three. That you do every day, and it might be 2 minutes three times a day or 1 minute three times a day. A passive exercise is meant to be a multitasking exercise. It's just a habit correction. So if I have you do something, you'll do it up to 60 minutes a day in most cases, but it's meant to do something else because you're just doing habit correction of where to park the tongue. You're teaching the tongue, here's where you park, here's where you live, this is where you hang out. So do other things. The other benefit of when I do that also is it starts to make the back of the tongue fire, which is very important for people who are having trouble in that area. So time commitment, I would say, aside from the passive exercise, which like I said, you'll do up to 60 minutes a day, the other ones, it's just minutes. Okay, some of the exercises I assign 2 minutes a day, some 3 minutes a day. Sometimes I, if it's post-procedure and we're just dealing with the wound, and I do something 4 or 6 times a day, those are exercises that you're just trying to keep that wound, you're just caring for the wound. And so it's not necessarily like you have to have focused time to do the exercise. The other thing is I help you figure out how you can do you. If I'm asking you to do this and you want to do this, you have to figure it out so that you can do it. Some people just do their exercises twice a day and they just kind of divide the time. So the message here, you guys, is the time commitment is not enough to make you put off making the decision for sure. So what are your options? I'm answering for my practice, obviously, so not other people's, because I have several of you that are emailing saying, okay, I wanna make sure that I do the right thing, and what are the options, what is my best choice? So traditional therapy is completely one-on-one. If you are that person who learns best being shown, when I do one-on-one therapy with somebody, I teach, I demonstrate, you demonstrate to me, I correct you, all of that stuff happens one-on-one. It is also the most comprehensive because it's 14 to 16, sometimes 18 or 20 sessions. It just depends. It allows me to teach advanced exercises. We teach breathing, sleep hygiene, posture, all of that stuff. Or sometimes it just allows me to not overwhelm you. Meaning I've had some ladies that say, Carmen, I'm only doing 4 things. Each time I'm only doing 4 things, and that includes the passive exercise. So if I overwhelm you and you have too much to do, you're not gonna do it anyhow. So that's why I say it's the most comprehensive and we have the most visits, because we do what works for you. Which also explains why it's 100% customizable. Not that I don't teach the same thing to everybody, and we'll talk about that here in just a minute, or at least the same basic foundational stuff to everybody, but with this, nothing is recorded. So if I say, ooh, I wanna move over here and do this, I can do that. If I'm teaching something to you and you're struggling with it and I have a different idea, then I can change that up. So that's traditional. Traditional is for you if you're not going to be accountable to anything else. It's obviously more expensive, but again, you're not in a hurry. So save the money to do it right, rather than take shortcuts. So I never want somebody to jump into something based just on price, and you've heard me say that before. Which leads me to hybrid. So hybrid is a video delivery and a live delivery. So it's created to save time and money. So I teach the exercises via video, and then you do live check-ins with me so I can correct you, so I can coach you, so I can do skills assessments with you to see how you're doing. Are you going to be okay to learn this way? You know the answer to that. Can you work independently without somebody holding your hand? If you're not going to do it, yeah, it's less than half the price, but that doesn't matter. Make sure that you choose something that works for you. And then this has a 12 lesson framework. So these are the most important building blocks. They can't be changed because the videos obviously are already created. That doesn't mean that we can't have conversation, or I can't say, okay, if this doesn't work, do this. But that's the difference. It's half the time with me, and a lot of people love it. It's very popular with people who have time concerns or financial concerns, but more than anything, I want you to know that it's gonna work good for you. And then your other option is the group therapy. And that is really what this challenge is all about. You have the accountability from the group members and also from me in a private Facebook group. But also, just because we do the therapy in a group setting, I don't want you to feel like you don't have access to me. All of my clients, no matter what program you're in, I'm just an email away. I'm just a video away. I've made videos to tell you how to do something in every place, grocery stores, my car, you name it. So you have a lot of support. So I don't want you to worry about that. This is 10 lessons over 14 weeks. So 2 of those are pre-procedure. I talked about this last night. 2 are pre-procedure, 8 are post-procedure. But you have access for, the paperwork says 6 months. It'll probably be a year till I need the group the next quarter of that next year. Slow and steady wins the race, you guys. I never want anybody to hurry through therapy. And while I have this over 14 weeks, so it's gonna be a little faster than you're used to, all you have to do is learn it if you want to, or watch it after the fact. So it's really up to you. And then group therapy is obviously the most affordable because more people can, I can teach more people at one time, but I do not want you making decisions based on price. So those are your options. Let's go over frequently asked questions. I have lots of them that you guys have given to me this week. I hope that I answer your questions if you still have them. If not, you can be typing them in. I will try and get them answered. If not live, then after we are done, because I'm trying not to be here forever tonight. Okay, so what about severe ties? I've had several of you email me and say, Carmen, I really want to commit, I really want to ditch my tie, but I have a severe tie. So, this happens a lot. In fact, probably a majority of my clients have severe ties versus those who don't. When somebody has a severe tie, I always talk about the pink elephant in the room. I want you to be prepared that you're going to have two releases. We call that a two-stage release. You plan for the worst and you hope for the best. And what happens when somebody has this kind of severe tie? You just can't get it all at once. So you get part of it, you do your therapy, you plug along. When you quit improving, that's a great time to do the second stage. Some providers have a time frame. Ideally, you want to wait as long as possible. If you go blasting back into that tissue when it's still raw and trying to heal, now you just created another inflammatory response. You risk having more scar tissue. So my plan of attack when I work with somebody, I have, again, that framework. We keep plugging along, then you get to a point and you do it again. You're already prepared for it, so it's not the end of the world. The biggest thing is that you just obviously get the wound again. You get uncomfortable again. I've had some clients who had severe ties. They had the first release. They're so happy. They don't want to do another one. They say, but Carmen, I'm fine. I don't want to perfect it. And I kind of have to push them over the ledge because they don't want to. And in the end, they're really glad that they do. So if you're somebody with a severe tie, you're preparing the same. The only thing that's a little bit different in somebody, sometimes people who have severe ties, that pre-procedure therapy is difficult. So what happens in that case is we have to take a little bit different approach. We do that and then we get the release so that we can even start functioning. I've had people who can't even get their tongue to the roof of their mouth. And so, like, not full tongue on the spot, just the tip of the tongue. And so doing pre-procedure therapy traditionally, like I'm going to teach tomorrow, which will be the first session that I teach everybody, suction and hold is part of that. They obviously can't do that. So we kind of take this on a case-by-case basis. I have some people that have very severe ties. They do excellent pre-procedure therapy. We wait 6, 8, 10 months before doing another one, and it's great. So if you're wondering about severe ties, just be prepared that that's probably what's going to happen. And it really is what should happen. Do you need a release for a mild tie? Okay, so it depends on who told you that you have a mild tie. I have lots of clients that, much to their dismay, by the time we do their checklist, by the time we do their exam, I look at their functional assessment, I look at their pictures, somebody was nuts when they said you have a mild tie. So oftentimes, dentists or doctors or whatever, they'll say, yeah, you've got a little something going on there, but it's not doing much damage. You function fine. My question is, who is that doctor? What's their background? And how did they assess it? Because if all they had you do is stick your tongue out, do you know how many people I send for very bad ties who stick their tongue out just fine? So that protrusion isn't the only tie, and it's extremely close-minded. So in those cases, when they tell you that you have a mild tie because it's not contributing to dysfunction or it's not affecting your oral function, then they're wrong if they don't do what I have walked you guys through over the last 2 days of doing your exam, okay? So in that case, I hate to burst your bubble, but maybe it's not a mild tie. In the case of if I am working with somebody and I say, you do have some mild restriction, sometimes I'm on the fence. It does not happen very often at all, but there's been a handful of times where I'm evaluating everything. And when I told you that I'm always justifying, if Dr. Zoggy calls, I need to be able to say this, this, and this. But the thing is, guys, it's okay to start therapy first and to figure it out too. And I don't like to do that because if somebody's got a tie, I want to prepare for it. I want them to get the most out of what they're paying me for. But if I've got somebody who definitely is mild, I clearly have put them through all of the tests. I've gathered all the data and I'm not 100% sold on the tie. I am happy to get started. And every single time I'm doing an assessment, I'm watching to make sure that they continue to get better. It's all about the function. And so if they get better and they don't hit a wall, then they're fine. I have people where all of a sudden they'll, you know, we'll be 9 or 10 months in and they'll say, so what about that tongue tie? And I look at their notes, I look at what we've done, and I said, you're in the clear because you have demonstrated everything. So that's a 50% one, 50% another. What if I'm a complex case? So this is, again, maybe a severe tie. Maybe it's because you have a complex medical history. Maybe you're a complex person. Maybe you're a hypochondriac and think everything's wrong with you, because I meet a lot of those too. With all due respect, when it comes to this, and when I'm working with somebody and I'm figuring out what kind of a case they're gonna be, I'm looking at this. It might have everything checked off here, you guys, and if it's all because of a tongue tie, then I call that easy peasy, because you're gonna be a easy case. It's just a classic case. Somebody who has a complex medical history, myofunctional therapy is non-invasive. There's no risk. You're always going to benefit rather than ever be harmed by doing myofunctional therapy. So I never want somebody to say, oh, should I be doing this? When I'm considering working with somebody, again, I'm thinking of those four goals. Those four things. How hard is it going to be to work with them? Is somebody going to be best served by traditional versus hybrid? That's really the only way that I discern somebody being a complex case, is if they're really wanting to do just video therapy. And I think based on what I've talked with them, based on the data that I've collected and the things, responses that they have had, that's when I will tell them, you know what? I'm giving you these options. You can do all of these different programs with me. I'm going to teach you the same stuff because that is so important. But if you feel like you're better served, sorry, I have an eyelash in my eye now. If you feel like you're better served doing a certain thing, then I want you to do that. Another thing that I think of when I think of complex cases is we have to really stay focused on what I'm doing. Those four goals. I know that people who have chronic pain, who have lots of issues, they've had this really complex medical history. They want all of it solved. And I have to focus on what I do best. You guys, my expertise is an inch wide and a mile deep. That's how I want it. I don't want to know a little bit about everything because I want to stay in my lane and help you with what I know best. And so sometimes for people who are complex people, I have to remind them that, yes, I understand that you're having drama with your mom, alcoholic mom, and you know all of that stuff. And I don't mean this disrespectfully at all, but I have to bring them back around to what we're working on, okay? I think that answers that. Do I specifically need someone else to diagnose my tie, or can I call the doctor myself? You don't have to have a referral for this kind of stuff. When I do a full exam on somebody, you get a report, okay? And so that's great. I call that arming yourself with knowledge. You can take it to the doctor. Very often I send it. But you don't need that. Diagnosing is an interesting word here, because we always say that we're identifying what the data is showing us. So, you know, we don't diagnose sleep apnea, a sleep researcher or a sleep doctor with a polysomnogram diagnoses that. But we identify the risk factors and the concerns where we're saying, hey, this is what this is showing. So if you call a doctor and you say, hey, I've met with Carmen. I have a lot of people that say, hey, I've done an assessment with Carmen. I have a report from Carmen. They're not going to turn you away. If they do, you don't want to be working with that person anyhow. Those doctors are still going to do their own assessment. It's just like you don't call a dental office and say, hey, I need a filling. You go to the dental office, they make their own diagnosis. Yes, there's decay, then they do a filling. So we're just helping gather that data, that information. You're never going to go to an office and have somebody say, no, you don't need to be here. Can everyone benefit from a release? Most everyone, yes. If you have significant myofunctional impairment, no matter what kind of restriction, then you can benefit from a release. Everybody's experience is going to be different. One of the biggest problems I see is people, they focus really on, oh, I just want that tension to be gone. I want that headache to be gone. I want you to think about those four goals and the big umbrella, the big picture of wellness and the impairment, not just one symptom. Because if, like, somebody reached out to me yesterday for ear pain, and that's the only thing she wants to fix. She isn't so sure about the open mouth resting posture, which I watched while I talked with her. She has sleep concerns. She really didn't mark much on her discovery checklist, most of which, because I think it was just left blank, but I think it definitely applied to her. She is not ready to look at everything. She only wants to focus on the ear. And so I was cautioning her that she may not, this may not be for her. Everybody else can benefit from a release in most cases. I hope that made sense. Can I benefit from myofunctional therapy without a release? Yes. Unless you're somebody who has such severe restriction, you're really going to struggle. Anybody, like I said, if you get started and we're on the fence and we're trying to figure it out, it's about function. It's not about the appearance, okay? And so anybody can benefit. You guys, I did not have a tongue tie, and I did myofunctional therapy years ago, and I had to. I needed to, because I couldn't satisfy any of the four goals of therapy, but I didn't need a release. What if I don't have a tie, but I have an OMD? Can I benefit from therapy? Oh, I just answered that. So that was me. Can I start myo and see if I need a release? Yes, I think I've answered that too. And sometimes that is a very sound way to go. Can I start myo if I have TMJ concerns? I just touched on that too. If you have an acute situation, then you gotta let that settle. So that might be a week, that might be a couple weeks. My clients who have TMJ issues, which I would say probably a majority of my clients, they do, because they have tongue ties, and that muscle that I've told you about, the styloglossus that inserts back here by the joint, it's a very big culprit in that issue. So they just have to take it a little bit slower. So in their case, maybe it takes them 3 or 4 days to do 1 or 2 days worth of therapy. But they can. I just can't have you start if you're in an inflamed, acute, miserable situation, because you're going to make it worse. How do I know if I have an OMD? If you aren't satisfying any of those four goals, if your tongue is down, if your mouth is open, if your mouth breathing, if you're snoring, anything that's altering the function of the oral muscles, then you have an OMD. Do I have to have expansion? This is a very important question that I get asked a lot. Children who need it need to have it. But since I'm talking to adults, and this is for adults, I want to tell you that in an ideal world, if you don't have enough room in your mouth for everything, then you could have expansion. But you don't necessarily have to. And I'm cautious when I say that, because when I think about myself, my teeth, you know, I was getting braces for the third time. Since I corrected my myofunctional impairment, my teeth haven't shifted. They're almost perfect, but not quite. And the reason that they're not quite perfect is because there's not enough room in my stadium for all the chairs. So there's a little bit of crowding. And I am horrified to say that I had an orthodontist years ago who also did reduction in between my teeth to make my teeth skinnier so that they would line up nicer. I have no problem getting my tongue to the roof of my mouth. I always tell my clients, if you have a tongue that's too wide, mine is wider than my arch, you learn to get your tongue inside and you put the rest of it in the roof of your mouth. You've got this high arch. That is very realistic to me. I get so many people that say, wow, therapist so-and-so said, or doctor so-and-so said, that I have to have expansion before I do A, B, and C. You have to consider what you're willing to do. People say, Carmen, I simply can't afford it. I'm simply not interested. You guys, I don't have breathing concerns. I don't have airway concerns. So that also makes a big difference. In my practice, in my hundreds of clients, I've had two people that have a more of a V-shaped palate than a U-shape. They had bigger fish to fry than worrying about their tongue tie. So I definitely told them, hey, we got to do something before we worry about that phrenectomy. So in their cases, expansion needed to be completed. But also you have to just consider what works for you. Lots of my clients get their tongue where it needs to be with no concerns. And I've even had doctors say, gosh, I didn't think that so-and-so was going to get their tongue in the roof of their mouth, and it fits up there. So it's fine. So the answer, the long answer to this was, you don't have to do anything. Some providers will say, no, I'm worried about doing a release on you if you're not so wide or whatever. Get second opinions. Get third opinions. Make sure that it makes sense to you and be careful what they're trying to sell you. Because I went through this with my daughter, my youngest daughter, who has upper airway resistance and sleep apnea. We saw one specialist and they were going to, they had the answer. And $8,500 later, and they were gonna just give her the appliance that she needed. But I went to other specialists and found out that the appliance for just the mere $8,500 wasn't gonna solve her issue. They were gonna expand her this way. She needed anterior posterior growth. And so that would have been really frustrating to spend that. So be open to getting second opinions is all I can say. I think we're almost getting down here, and then I'll see your guys' other questions. What if the doctor offers to do it right now while I'm there? Not your person, okay? If you go to talk to a doctor about your tongue tie to have it diagnosed and they tell you that it's gonna take just a couple minutes, you're in the wrong place. And here in just a couple of slides, maybe the next one, I'm gonna talk about finding a good provider. You guys, you don't find it on the first try. Unless it's somebody, you know, unless I'm lucky enough to be able to refer a client, we have to kind of just wade through that. So if you go to an office, you wanna have a consult about the tie to find out about their procedure, all of that stuff. If they say, can I do it right now? They're not your tongue tie savvy person because they're not mandating myofunctional therapy. They're not even thinking about it because there's not a chance that you're ready. So you run from that building like it's on fire and you don't call that person back. Oh, next slide. How do I find a good tongue tie savvy provider? I earlier in the evening posted some links in this Facebook group for you guys. Those are great questions to start with. You gotta pick up the phone and call. If anybody stumbles over the questions that you're asking them, they're off the list. If they tell you that, yeah, they can do it, they're off the list. Every dentist, you know, or lots of providers, I've honestly never used an oral surgeon. I've never used a periodontist. I've only ever used dentists. So some people use other specialists, but the whole thing is this, the outcome is the same. Just because they learned it in school doesn't mean that they should be doing it. So when you're calling these offices and you're asking these questions, like if they normally do phrenectomies on infants, but they're going to let you be their guinea pig, not my clients. That's what I always say is, no, we all have to learn somewhere, but you're not going to learn on my people because I know how important it is to have it right. So ask questions. If you're a mama, you've got woman's intuition. Or I should say, if you're a female, you've got woman's intuition. So what's your gut tell you? Did they fumble with the questions? Or is this something that they go through every day? They know their process. They know their price. They know their procedure. Boom, boom, boom. That's probably your person. Okay. So go through the questions and then also ask. But I will caution you. So Facebook groups, everybody's always talking about preferred providers. And I wish it really was preferred because I know that there's names on there that have zero experience. They just want to get started. I also know that there's names on there that certainly have terrible practice philosophies. They don't do active wound management. They don't know anything about myofunctional therapy, or they really don't even believe in it. And so just be careful. Just because somebody else has given a lovely review about an office and they went in and everybody was friendly and they had fresh Toll House cookies and whatever, and they had great chairside manner, that means they're lovely people and that you might like them otherwise, but they don't need to do your phrenectomy. So take some time, plan some time to find the right person. Okay, so what to do for tomorrow? I want you to have your workbook that has the lesson one papers in it. Decide if you're the person, if you're still trying to figure out what quarter you want to commit to. Remember, if it's not quarter four, you have options next year too. You can choose to get enrolled now so that you don't have to worry about a price increase. Completely up to you. I want it to be the right time, the right everything for you. And then tomorrow, I want you to bring patience and grace. Beginning myofunctional therapy is an eye-opening experience. I always tell my clients, you're going to hate me before you love me. And that's just because if you have impairment, you start using muscles that you're not used to. And it's tiring. It's difficult. I think that is it. Again, here's the email if you want to get enrolled. I'm going to look here because I saw some other questions. Let me see. Okay. Okay, so Leslie says, are two lessons enough before a release for most? Yes, in my case, my standards, and let me say two lessons and 2 months. So it's a little bit, I like to say 6 to 8 weeks, but if I have my way and I can have somebody do pre-procedure therapy for 8 weeks, that's what I'm doing. And that came because I was having somebody come from Paris to LA to see Dr. Zaghi, and I could not risk them being right or not being prepared. And so, you know, other offices have their standards, and I wanted to just have mine a little bit higher because if your person gets in the chair, they're nervous, and obviously they falter, they're still going to be great. I had a provider in the United States that had previously reached out to me and said, oh, I think that people need to do therapy for a lot longer, more sessions. I don't want to spend a bunch of your therapy time teaching you how to do something when you've got a handicap. Okay, having that tongue tie is what I consider a handicap. So I want to have you prepared the best I can for the release, and then we do it after that. So that provider also has since then been dumbfounded about how well my clients are prepared. So I'm sold. Two lessons before. The only time I would ever do more with somebody is maybe if I had somebody with special needs, obviously, or if there was some extenuating circumstance.